50 million Christians died, suffering at the hands of Rome, 'cause they believed in Christ alone. They died through Europe, especially Spain, for they saw all but Christ in vain. He suffered by his death for men, to save them from their awful sin. 600 years of martyred saints that history cannot erase. With iron heel and iron hand, the Roman popes rule the land. Those ignorant of history may be swept into apostasy. We won't be lulled by Rome's sweet lie, with 50 million reasons why. Salvation is by faith alone, in Christ alone, by grace alone. A sovereign God give faith to man, salvation's in the Maker's hand. This gospel offends Rome today. They offer up another way, a counterfeit, a compromise. Beware the ancient papal lie, with such a cloud of witnesses who by grace died in their Lord. Recall their memory to say, by the same faith we live today.
Good evening. Welcome to Romanism and the Reformation Bible Study. My name's Tom Fress, and I'll be your host for the next hour. We're reading the book Romanism and the Reformation by Henry Grattan Guinness. Last time we concluded at page 21, about halfway down the page. So if you find your own copy of this book or the online copy from which I am reading from archive.org, Romanism and the Reformation from University of Toronto, the pagination will be the same if you'd like to read along from that version. This is a two-hour program. The first hour will be reading the text and commenting. And then after an hour of reading, then an hour of discussion from the listeners. And it's my pleasure to be here. We ask the Lord's blessing on the reading and understanding of this book, Romanism and the Reformation by Henry Grattan Guinness. May the Lord restore our Protestant knowledge. Now, last time, pardoning my absence from last week over an oversight of mine, but 2 weeks ago, we concluded on page 21 of the book, and by a brief way of refreshing our memories, since it has been 2 weeks and since we've already covered the first 21 pages of the book, what Henry Grattan Guinness is doing is laying out the history of the papacy from its beginnings until this period of time, when the papacy has literally grown from just a bishop among bishops to the bishop of all bishops, and then finally to King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And you might say to yourself, well, that's blasphemy. Indeed, it is. And the Bible prophesies that the papacy will be a blasphemer. And we have seen the historical rise of the papacy from simply a bishop among bishops to bishop of all bishops, still subject to the emperor, the civil power of Europe, until he rises to become superior to even the Roman emperor and all of the kings of the emperor, or all of the kings of Europe. I want to back up just as a matter of refreshing to page 19. He says this was a tremendous elevation, the first upward step on the ladder that led the bishops of Rome from the humble pastorate of a local church to the mightiest throne in Europe. But still, all that was claimed or granted was simply episcopacy. In other words, power within and over the church, though of a universal kind, he says. No thought of secular government existed at this period. In other words, no thought of sovereignty over secular governments. We're talking about a period where the papacy was just an ecclesiastical or an episcopacy within the church. Now, the matter, however, did not stop here. This supreme episcopal jurisdiction led to constant interferences of the Roman bishop in the affairs of the various nations of Christendom, and to ever-increasing pretensions to authority in matters secular as well as ecclesiastical, until 500 years later in A.D. 1073. That's the year 1073, Pope Gregory VII, and I correctly say Antichrist Gregory VII, took a great stride in advance and established a theocracy on earth. The world experienced for the first time a man who was head of the church and head of the state, a supreme pontiff. Every man, woman, and child on the planet, all the kings and all the people, were under the direct authority of Pope Gregory VII in 1073, a papal theocracy, King of kings and Lord of lords. He was the first who claimed as the representative of deity to be above all the kings in the world. This proud and self-exalting man strove successfully, not only to emancipate the spiritual power, that is, the power of the church, from all control by the state, not only to secure for it absolute independence, but further, to subject the secular power of princes, that is, the kings of the earth, to the spiritual power of priests. Okay? And you might know that the priest of priests is the Pope. Okay? And thus to establish at Rome, in his own person, and in the succession of the Roman pontiffs, an absolute and supreme rule of the world. You comprehend this? That under this pontificate, Pope Gregory VII, the whole world was the Pope's jurisdiction, King of kings and Lord of lords. Now it says, nor did he propound this new and startling doctrine as a theory only. With daring audacity, he excommunicated the German Emperor Henry IV, and he released his subjects from allegiance to him and forbade them to obey him as sovereign. So here, in exercise of his divine right as King of Kings, he excommunicates Henry VII and strips him of his kingly power and subjects his people to renounce allegiance to him. And he forbade the people to obey him. This has never been done in the world. And this Pope did it for the first time, proving his King of Kings status. He actually succeeded in exacting humiliating concessions from the emperor and yet he subsequently bestowed his kingdom on another. So even after Henry IV relented and regained the Pope's confidence, still the Pope replaced him and gave his kingdom to another. And it says, this Pope turned the bishopric of Rome into a universal and unlimited monarchy. Okay? And the sovereigns of Europe were unable to oppose his unprecedented usurpations. Now, you see Bible prophecy being fulfilled? This is Antichrist. This is a man on the earth who presumes to forgive sins, who presumes to reign over all the kings and all the people of the world in a supreme, unlimited, kingly, and priestly status. This is the very throne of Almighty God. This is what the Bible prophecies prophesy, that he would speak great things and blasphemies against the Most High. He would think to change times and laws. And we know that this is the fulfillment of Bible prophecy, and we find it in history. True Protestant, or rather world history. These things are not debated. These are a matter of record, accepted by all parties concerned. Now, it says, he established also an undisguised and irresistible despotism over the national churches in other lands. Okay, he was Lord of Lords. In other words, priest of priests. And just as much as he was a despot over the kings, he was also a despot over the priests. He established also an undisguised and irresistible despotism over the national churches in other lands by enacting that no bishop in the Roman Catholic Church should enter on the enterprise of his functions. In other words, he cannot be a priest until the Pope had confirmed his election, a law of far-reaching and vast importance by which perhaps more than by any other means, Rome sustained for centuries her temporal power as well as her ecclesiastical power. And I concluded last time's broadcast by showing you that because the papacy claimed the divine right to pick the priests and the bishops of the Roman Catholic Church in every land, that these priests and bishops literally had to answer to the Pope and the Pope alone. If the Pope picked them and elected them, then he was their sovereign, and they had to obey the Pope. No matter what government they were responsible to, they were responsible first and foremost to the Pope of Rome. And this, in history, is where it is established what is known today as the shadow government. In every country in the world where there is a Roman Catholic Church, there are Roman Catholic priests and bishops elected by the papacy, subservient and responsible only to the Pope, and it is through these priests and bishops that the Pope runs roughshod over the governments of these nations and keeps an eye on the kings and the politicians of every land. This is how the Pope keeps his thumb on the governments of the world. It's through his bishops and cardinals and priests. The hierarchy of the Roman Catholic Church is the shadow government in every nation on the planet. When a government passes laws that are contrary to Roman Catholic canon law, the priests and the bishops and the cardinals of that nation go into warfare against that government, controlling the minds and the hearts of the Roman Catholics within every diocese, in every jurisdiction in that land, and they overthrow the government. They change the laws. They go into active warfare to achieve whatever directives that they receive from the Pope. This is how governments are overturned. This is how regime takes place, even today. Okay, I want everyone to realize that though this was 1,500 years ago or 1,000 years ago, nothing has changed. The system still exists, and it still operates today, even with even more sophistication and control than it did during the Dark Ages. Now, I'll continue in the middle of page 21. Many of the constant quarrels between our own English kings, remember Henry Grattan Guinness is giving this series of lectures in England. He's speaking to a live audience in England, an overflow audience, by the way, an audience that contains even the blue bloods of England, all the way down to the street sweepers. The audience is filling the house and even spilling out into the streets. People came from everywhere to listen to this man preach and teach. And he says to this group, many of the constant quarrels between our own early kings and the popes of Rome, as well as many similar feuds on the continent, arose out of this flagrant usurpation of national rights and invasion of national liberties. So the priests and the bishops and the cardinals and the popes together put every nation into a continual state of feuding, okay, because they were trying to meddle in the national affairs of every nation and to disturb the national liberties. The papacy says that a man's only rights are those which the Pope gives him. So if he and his shadow government are operating in a nation such as England that had been dominated by Protestantism and had given the people natural civil rights, freedom of speech, freedom of the press, freedom of conscience, freedom of religion, the Pope damns all of these rights and is constantly on the charge to try to overturn these governments that support these rights. And he was just as active in England and the other as he was on the mainland of Europe. And he says it virtually took from the churches the power to appoint their own bishops and place them under a foreign despotism. This, again, is another effort of Henry Grattan Guinness to impress upon your mind that every priest, every bishop, every cardinal, every hierarch of the Roman Catholic Church owed his first allegiance to a foreign despot, the papacy. And this is where the contention always existed. Imagine, if you will, the United States having, now they don't, but they don't, the Muslims only have less than 1% of the population of this country. But just imagine in the United States of America that there were 25% of the population were Roman Catholics, and their jurisdictions, their priestly bishoprics and cardinalates were uniformly spread all over this land. And the Muslims were 25% and had the same overlapping jurisdiction, and they were answering to an imam in Saudi Arabia or Iraq or Iran or some other place like that. The American people would be in an outrage that we have these Muslims who have no responsibility to our country, no loyalty to our country, have an agenda to take over our country, to strip us of all of our rights, and to put the imam, King of Kings and Lord of Lords in this country. The American people would be outraged. There'd be war overnight. But literally, what we have in this country is the same state of affairs that existed in England and the mainland Europe at the time. Even in the Protestant nations that had sworn off Roman Catholicism and made Protestantism the national religion, such as England, Here we have the Roman Catholic hierarchy, which is more lethal, and more controlling, more dictatorial, more despotic than any Muslim religion of history. And they are constantly at war, through the bishops, the priests, and the cardinals, together with the Pope, trying to overthrow the liberties of the people and messing in the national affairs of every nation. He says it virtually took from the churches the power to appoint their own bishops and place them under a foreign despotism. So the Pope is in complete control of the churches and of the bishops and the priests. And it says the clergy of all nations were by this time enslaved to the papacy. Let me read it again. The clergy of all nations were by this time, 1074, enslaved to the papacy. And by obeying its bulls of excommunication and giving effect to its interdicts, they placed in the Pope's hand a lever to move the world. That's the old world order. The Pope moved the world through the lever that he exerted through his bishops, his priests, and his cardinals, and the hierarchy of the Roman Catholic Church in every land. He literally controlled every nation. And it says during the interdict, if the Pope was at war with a king, a particular Protestant king possibly, he would place an interdict on that nation, which means all the Roman Catholic churches would be closed. Just put a padlock on the door. Nobody can go to church. Well, in the Roman Catholic world, that means you can't get married. You can't have your baby baptized. You can't participate in the Eucharist. You can't eat the Jesus cookie. You can't do anything. As a matter of fact, if you die when the church is closed, you can't have extreme unction. You can't have your sins forgiven. You can't confess your sins to a priest because the ecclesiastical system has been closed. So in the Roman Catholic world, if you die having unconfessed sins, you go to purgatory and you must have them burnt off, as it were. So if the Pope closes the churches, the Roman Catholic churches in your kingdom, trust me, the Roman Catholics are going to do whatever they have to do to get that church open. And if it means overthrowing the government, waging a civil war against the government, or simply not obeying the king, that's precisely what they do. And the history is just dripping with examples of this. This is the power wielded by the Pope to make him King of Kings and Lord of Lords. This is what is so idolatrous about the Roman Catholic Church. They don't worship Jesus Christ in the Roman Catholic Church. They worship the Pope. They do what he says. Even the kings of the earth did. And trust me, it's no different today than it was then. Now, the author says, during the interdict, the churches in a country were all closed, bells silent, the dead unburied. In other words, you couldn't have a funeral. And Roman Catholics aren't ones to just go out and bury somebody. You have to be buried in a Catholic funeral. Okay? It says the dead unburied. No masses could be performed. No rites except those of baptism and extreme unction celebrated. So the Pope made an exception. Obviously, it's to his benefit. If every baby born is baptized into the Roman Catholic Church, that gives the Roman Catholic Church ownership of that baby. And also extreme unction is a benefit to the papacy because it is during the last rites given to the dying Roman Catholic that the church has an opportunity to gain a bequest from the estate of the dying person. So in the beginning of life, baptism, the Roman Catholic Church gains, and at the end of life, near death, the Roman Catholic Church gains by extreme unction. everything else, according to the ecclesiastical laws of the church, are done away with during the interdict. Now, he says, this state of things was so dreadful to a superstitious age that monarchs were obliged to yield lest their people should revolt. The result of every such interdict was an increase to the power of the papacy, and they soon brought all refractory rulers in Europe to terms. This was enough power for the papacy to gain every kind of control over every king of Europe. This is how he maintained his status as King of Kings and Lord of Lords, through the interdict. Now, when the maxims of Gregory VII had been acted out for a century, and the power to trample on the necks of kings had come to be regarded by churchmen as an inherent and rather a divine right of the papacy, the proud spirit of papal aggression reached its climax. The period of climax may be dated from the pontificate of Pope Innocent III in AD 1198. The leading objects which the Roman pontiffs had steadily pursued for centuries seemed at last attained. Independent sovereignty, absolute supremacy over the Christian church, and full control over the princes of Europe. The historian Hallam says of this man, quote, he was formidable beyond all his predecessors, perhaps beyond all his successors. On every side, the thunder of Rome broke over the heads of princes. And here the author gives us a note. He says, the three great sovereigns of Western Europe, the kings of Germany, of France, and England, had seen their realms under papal interdict, themselves under sentences of excommunication. But the papal power under Pope Innocent not only aspired to humble the loftiest, hardly one of the smaller kingdoms had not already been taught or was not soon taught to feel the awful majesty of the papacy. From the Northern Ocean to Hungary, from Hungary to the Spanish shore of the Atlantic, Pope Innocent III is exercising that what takes the language of protective or parental authority, but which in most cases is asserted by the terrible interdict, unquote. Again, that's from the historian Milman in his work entitled History of Latin Christianity, Volume 5, page 305. Now, this pope excommunicated Sweno, the king of Norway, threatened the king of Hungary to alter the succession. In other words, the king of Hungary was not going to be able to pass down his crown to his chosen successor. The pope was going to see to it that whoever he wanted to rule Hungary was going to get to rule. He put down the kingdom of Castile under interdict. And when Philip Augustus of France refused at his bidding to take back his repudiated wife, Innocent did not hesitate to punish the whole nation by putting France also under the same dreaded penalty until her king humbly submitted to the pope's behest. He ruled over the kings of the earth, even meddled in their own marital affairs. Remember, marriage is a sacrament in the Roman Catholic Church. According to Roman Catholic canon law, no one is lawfully wed unless he is married by a Roman Catholic priest. And these kings who were under the papal authority could not dispose of their wives without the king's permission or without the pope's permission. Now, this was the case even in England under King Henry VIII. But we're going to talk about King John now. King John of England and Philip II of Aragon were both constrained to resign their kingdoms, in other words, hand their crowns to the pope, and then receive them back from the pope as spiritual fiefs of the Roman pontiff, who claimed also the right to decide the election of the emperors of Germany by this confirmation or veto. So if you were in dispute with the papacy, as was King John, by what authority did he wear his crown? The Pope worked it against King John so that to not suffer an interdict in England and not succumb the same way as all the other kings of Europe did, King John just simply removed his crown and handed it to the Pope. And then the Pope handed it right back to him and stuck it on his head. And that by that means, Pope John submitted to the Pope, or King John submitted to the Pope as a literal fief, a fiefdom. He made England a fiefdom of the papacy. And that's still observed by Roman Catholic canon law today. That England, no matter if it's kings and queens, take a Protestant oath, in the papacy's mind, England is, was, and always will be a fiefdom of the Roman pontiff. See, nothing has changed. Only our perceptions have changed. Nothing has changed at all. Now, here's a quote. The noonday of papal dominion extends from the pontificate of Pope Innocent III inclusively to that of Pope Boniface VIII, or in other words, throughout the 13th century. Rome inspired during this age all the terror of her ancient name. She was once more the mistress of the world, and kings were her vassals. In other words, Papal Rome, or the Holy Roman Empire, had already gained all the power and authority and might that the old pagan Roman Empire had. The only difference between the two is the name. The old Roman Empire and the new Roman Empire. Now, here the author gives us another reference that, if you care to look this up for yourself, this comes from Hallam's History of the Middle Ages, page 368 in the fourth edition. Now he continues at the top of page 24. He says, Innocent III claimed also the right to dispense with both civil and canon law when he pleased, and to decide cases by the plenitude of his own inherent power. I want to make sure you understand this. Pope Innocent III, claiming to be the replacement of the Son of God on earth and having all the power and jurisdiction of Christ on earth, arrogated to himself not only King of Kings status and Lord of Lords status, but that he was a supreme authority over every law, both the human and divine, and that he could dispense with any law that he chose, whether it was man's law or whether it was God's law. The ultimate blasphemy committed by Pope Innocent III. He dispenses also, says Henry Grattan Guinness, with the obligation of promises made on oaths, undermining thus the force of contracts and treaties. In other words, he could do away with any oath taken by anybody. He could simply speak a word and absolve you from any and every oath. He could release one from any contract or any treaty. And treaty law, I am told, is the most powerful law of mankind, the law of treaties. And the Pope arrogated to himself the power to even dispense with treaties. National and international law. Think of the ramifications that the papacy has today to dispense with canon law, his own law, to dispense with the laws of heaven, the Ten Commandments, and also national and international treaty law and contracts. That's the power that is wielded by the papacy today. Just as much as it was then. Now, the military power of the papacy dates also from this man, as the Crusades had left him in possession of an army. Okay? The papacy controlled the armies of all of Europe. Everywhere in his jurisdiction, those armies were at his disposal. He said systematic persecution of so-called heretics began also in this pontificate. What did the Pope use the kings and the armies of the world to do? To wage crusades against God's people. They called them heretics because they would not obey the Pope. They saw him as the Antichrist of the Bible. They would not come to Mass. They would not confess their sins to priests. They would not bow down and worship images and idols. They rejected the Roman Catholic Church as the synagogue of Satan and the Pope as Antichrist. And for that, they were deemed by the papacy to be heretics. And under Roman Catholic canon law, it was a meritorious work to kill a heretic. Now, he says the corruptions, cruelties, and assumptions of the papacy had become so intolerable that protests were making themselves heard in many quarters. It was felt these must be silenced at any cost, and a wholesale slaughter of heretics was commenced with a view of their extermination. The Inquisition was founded. The Albigensians and the Waldensians were murderously persecuted, and superstition and tyranny were at their height. Look what the papacy does when he gains to himself all the powers of heaven and earth unto himself. What does he do? Begins to kill God's people, just like the Bible says. He is drunk with the blood of the saints and the blood of the martyrs of Jesus. Prophecy being fulfilled in history. Now he says, from this century, papal persecution of the witnesses for the truth never ceased until the final establishment of Protestantism at the end of the 17th century. In AD 1294, Pope Boniface VIII became pope, and by his superior audacity, he threw into the shade even Pope Innocent III. He deserves to be designated the most usurping of mankind, as witness his celebrated bull entitled Unum Sanctum. In this document, the full claims of the papacy come out. We've noted several ever-increasing stages of papal assumption already, but now we reach the climax, the claim which, if it were a true one, would abundantly justify all the rest. We reach the towering pinnacle of the topmost peak of human exaltation. What was the claim of Pope Boniface VIII? It was that, quote, the Pope represents God upon earth, unquote. As this claim is the most extraordinary and audacious ever made by mortal man, I will state it, not in my own words, but in the words of the highest papal authority. In the summary of things concerning the dignity, authority, and infallibility of the Pope, set forth by Pope Boniface VIII, are these words, quote, the Pope is of so great dignity and excellence that he is not merely a man, but as it were God, and the vicar of God. The Pope alone is called most holy, divine monarch, and supreme emperor, and king of kings. The Pope is of so great dignity and power that he constitutes one and the same tribunal with Christ, so that whatsoever the Pope does seems to proceed from the mouth of God. The Pope is as God on earth, unquote. The height of Antichrist, Pope Boniface VIII, in his bull, Unum Sanctum. Now, Henry Grattan Guinness continues. that which was claimed by Pope Boniface VIII in the 13th century has been claimed ever since by a succession of popes down to Pope Pius IX and Leo XIII in the 19th century. These were the popes that were reigning at the time of the writing of this book in the late 1800s. Pope Pius IX had just been succeeded by Pope Leo XIII. He continues, he says, the Pope speaks today as the vicar of Christ, as God's vicegerent. The Great Ecumenical Council of 1870 proclaimed him such and declared him to be infallible. A professor of history in the Roman University, writing on the Council of 1870, uses the following language, which strikingly expresses the papal ideal. Quote, the Pope is not a power among men to be venerated like another, but he is a power altogether divine. He is the propounder and teacher of the law of the Lord in the whole universe. He is the supreme leader of the nations to guide them in the way of eternal salvation. He is the common father and universal guardian of the whole human species in the name of God. The human species has been perfected in its natural qualities by divine revelation and by the incarnation of the Word, and has been lifted up to a supernatural order in which alone can it find its temporal and eternal felicity. The treasures of revelation, the treasures of truth, the treasures of righteousness, the treasures of supernatural graces upon earth have been deposited by God in the hands of one man who is the sole dispenser and keeper of them. The life-giving work of the divine incarnation, work of wisdom, of love, of mercy, is ceaselessly continued in the ceaseless actions of one man, thereto ordained by providence. This man is the Pope. This is evidently implied in his designation itself, the Vicar of Christ. For if he holds the place of Christ upon earth, that means that he continues the work of Christ in the world and is in respect to of us what Christ would be if he were here below, himself visibly governing the church. This was a quote that is cited in the work entitled The Pope, the Kings, and the People by Reverend William Arthur, Volume 1, page 211. This is real history. And to suggest that this does not constitute, in its totality, the description of the papacy as the biblical, historical, and prophetic Antichrist, then I dare say no human being could ever hold that title. But we know that the papacy is the Antichrist spoken of in the Scripture, the little horn of Daniel, the man of sin, the son of perdition, and the Antichrist of the apostles Paul and John. It speaks of none other than the papacy. And the only reason the world does not realize this today is because futurism has replaced the historical interpretation of the prophecy. No longer do men look in history to discover the fulfillment of Bible prophecy, but they say that Antichrist doesn't come until the last 7 years before Christ returns, totally exonerating the papacy and therefore justifying the papacy together with the kings of the earth, together with the Jesuits, to suppress this historical information in all forms of education, whether it be public education or Christian education. This history has been hidden from us. And to correct ourselves of our futurist error, we must remember that futurism is the newest kid on the block. It was started just about the time of the beginning of the preaching by Henry Grattan Guinness. And no more than three or four generations of men have ever heard of this futurist interpretation, that Antichrist is a single man that comes just 7 years before Christ returns. Every Christian before our generations, the last three or four generations, have believed and taught. Friends shouted from the rooftops that it was the papacy from its very beginnings at the fall of the old Roman order, the times of the Caesars, to when the papacy rose in its place and taking upon itself the power and jurisdiction of the Caesars in the name of God. We need to return to historicism before it's too late. One more word before I continue with the text. And this you must comprehend after reading all that we've just read, that the New World Order is simply the reestablishment of the Old World Order. The Pope has regained his power in the world as King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And this global government, this global religion, the global economic system, the global social structure is going to be a papal theocracy. The papacy will be at the head of all of it. And now you must begin to ask yourselves, why have we been led down this ecumenical road to reunite with the Roman Catholic Church by our pastors? It can only be that the Roman Catholic Church, through her Jesuits, have gotten control of the Protestant seminaries, have removed Protestant history from the shelves, and have been preaching futurism ever since. If historicism was restored, futurism would destroy upon its own foundations, and the very foundations of the New World Order would crumble. So the success or failure of the New World Order can be said to be in whether or not God's people return to a historical understanding of the prophecies. If they do, Rome will crumble under her own weight. The New World Order will crumble under its own weight. If God's people, the very elect of God, continue to believe in futurism, then the papacy is free to continue to deceive the whole world. As goes God's people, so goes the nation, and so goes the world. Continue in futurism, then you will be ruled by the Antichrist of the Bible. Return to historicism, the papacy is exposed for all the world to see for what it is. The little horn of Daniel, the man of sin, the son of perdition, the biblical, historical, and prophetic Antichrist, and then the kingdom of Christ will be here on earth. Now, continue with the text. Do you hear these words? Do you take them in? Do you grasp the thought which they express? Do you perceive the main idea and central principle of the papacy? The Pope is not simply man, but is as if God, and the vicar of God, as God on earth. No wonder the sentences addressed to every pope on his coronation, quote, "Now thou art the father of princes and kings and the governor of the world," unquote. Did you know that that's what every pope is heralded when he becomes pope? This is what they say at his coronation ceremony, quote, "Know thou art the father of princes and kings and the governor of the world." You are the father of princes and kings and the governor of the world. That's what they say of the Pope when he's crowned and coronated at the Vatican. He says, no wonder that he is worshipped by cardinals and archbishops and bishops, by priests and monks and nuns innumerable, by all the millions of Roman Catholics throughout the world. No wonder that he has dethroned monarchs and given away kingdoms, dispensed pardons and bestowed indulgences, canonized saints, remitted purgatorial pains, promulgated dogmas, and issued bulls and laws and extravagance, led laid empires under interdicts, bestowed benedictions, and uttered anathemas. Who is like unto him in all the earth? What are great men, philosophers, statesmen, conquerors, princes, kings, and even emperors of the earth compared to the Pope? Their glory is of the earth, earthy. His is from above. It is divine. He is the representative of Christ, the creator and redeemer, the Lord of all. He is as Christ. He takes the place of Christ. He is as God on earth. This blasphemous notion is the keystone of the entire papal arch. It is the stupendous axis on which the whole papal world has rotated for ages and is rotating at this hour. And remember, the hour that we are speaking is approximately 1874 AD when this book was written. And it's no different today. But to complete this very brief sketch of the history of Romanism, I may just remind you that long and checkered decline of papal dominion may be dated from the pontificate of Boniface VIII from the end of the 13th century. Early in the next century, Pope Clement V took the strange and fatal step of removing the seat of papal government from Rome to Avignon, France, where it remained for 70 years, greatly to the detriment of its authority and power. There it was, to some extent, dependent on the court of France, and it also lost the affections of Italy and the prestige of Rome. Then came the Great Schism, which seriously weakened and discredited the papacy. We're talking about the separation of the Eastern churches that were centered in Constantinople and extended all over the Baltic states. They got into a fight with the papacy. They would not accept the papacy as the head of their church. They wanted their own patriarch. There were some more feuds over dating when the Easter should be celebrated, another paganized Christian holiday, and also a dispute over image worship. And the Eastern Church broke away from the Western Church. They call it the Great Schism. It took place in 1054 AD. And it helped to discredit the papacy. What this author is describing for us in history is God's hand at work. During the time when the papacy had exalted itself to be God of all gods, King of all kings, God began to make a mockery of the papacy, insofar as it even had to move its throne from Rome to Avignon, France. And to some degree, even had to come under the jurisdiction of the French government. And then the church split in half, the East and Western sects of the Roman Catholic Church. The papacy's power was divided, even in his own church. This is the hand of providence. This is God making a mockery of this great blasphemer of Scripture. Now, he says, rival popes ruled at Rome and Avignon. The papacy got into a feud. There became two popes, if you can imagine this. And even at one time, there were three popes in the Roman Catholic Church, all hurling anathemas at one another, all claiming that the other was the Antichrist. And I always laugh and say they were all absolutely correct. God is literally making a mockery of the papacy. There were rival popes, one ruling at Rome and another in Avignon, France. Corruption and rapacity, demoralization and disaffection rapidly increased, and there supervened the darkest hour of the night, which preceded the dawn. Now, let me add some more to your understanding. In this day and age, where the Pope's New World Order is all but a done deal, all being assembled by the help of the United States military conquering the rest of the world for the Pope, and we have an ecumenical global religion of all the pagan religions of the world coming under the ecclesiastical authority of the papacy, we have all the governments of the world cooperating with the Pope, in its designs for Israel. And we have all over the world global economic collapse. We have the destruction of human rights all over the world. The papacy is putting into practice its age-old suppression of human rights. God has demoralized the Roman Catholic Church by exposing the global pedophile priest pandemic. Here we have providence, divine providence. There is no excuse for a man of God who has his eyes and ears open that does not know about this new world order and has figured out that it's simply the old world order restored, and God is opposed to it, and God has brought division right in the Roman Catholic Church over its biblical economic upheavals. Even the Vatican Bank has a history that is known all over the world for being a bank of corruption. And we have the priesthoods in every nation being reviled by every government and peoples for its historical and continued pedophile priest pandemic. It's global. And one would have to be a cadaver not to know about it. And even worse, not to care about it. God is fully exposing the corruption of the Roman Catholic Church. And I believe the corruption has gotten so bad as part of the reason why they elected a Jesuit pope this time around. Pope Francis I is at least on his face going to try to do something about all this corruption. But God has already exposed it, and the world has a decision to make. Are they going to follow the yellow brick road back to Rome, or are they going to are they going to grasp back at the Protestant Reformation and stand firm with Christ, reestablish him and his sovereign rule over his house, and call Rome what it is, the synagogue of Satan and its papacy, the Antichrist of the Bible? Now, Henry Grattan Guinness continues in the middle of page 29, if you're following along. He says, ere long, Wycliffe, the morning star of the Reformation, arose, and at last came the blessed movement itself with Martin Luther and the rest of the reformers, which delivered Germany, England, and the other lands of the papal yoke, dividing Christendom into two camps, Romanists and Protestant. Vainly did Rome seek the frantic efforts to arrest and reverse this movement. Hecatombs of martyrs, oceans of blood, centuries of war, which still go on today, I will add, centuries of war could not stop it. At the beginning of the 16th century, Rome boasted that not a single heretic, not a single Protestant could be found. Now, Christendom contains 150 millions of those whom the papacy calls heretics and whom it would exterminate by fire and sword if it could. It did succeed in crushing out the Reformation movement in France, Spain, and Italy by awful Inquisition tortures, by bloody massacres, by cruel wars, by the revocation of the Edict of Nantes, by the deeds of such men as Philip of Spain and his Armada, and the Duke of Alva and his cruelties in the Netherlands. Rome recovered some of the ground she lost in the Protestant Reformation, and she still exercises spiritual power over 180 millions of mankind. Though her temporal power has overthrown for a time the French Revolution, and the joy of Italy brought it to an end in 1870, her claim to it is in no wise abated, nor her pretension that she has a right, a divine right, to rule the world. The religion of Rome has so disgusted the continental nations that, knowing nothing better, they have drifted into practical infidelity, and with one consent they have, to a large extent, despoiled the church of her revenues, secularized her property and her religious houses, and repudiated her interference in their respective governments. So we have two adversaries of the Antichrist and the synagogue of Satan. Number one was the Protestant Reformation, defeated error with truth. And then we have the French Revolution, that it had wanted nothing more whatsoever to do with religion. And it was a most lethal error, a most lethal attack against the papacy, because in France, these revolutionists confiscated all the Roman Catholic properties. And they stole from the papacy all of her churches, all of her monasteries, all of her lands, and they repatriated it back to the nations. So immediately after the height, the pinnacle of papal authority in the world, the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, God began to destroy her, and God did a very good job. The problem with today is Protestantism has taken a setback because it has believed in futurism and has forgotten the history of the papacy. It has forgotten who the Antichrist is. It has forgotten who God's enemy is, and put it on a fictitious future individual. All of that can be changed if futurism is renounced and repudiated and condemned and restore historicism to the hearts, minds, and churches of Jesus Christ. The New World Order is simply the Old World Order restored. If God's people remember who the Antichrist really is, then the papacy has a really rough row to hoe. Will it happen? Let's pray that it does. And let's make sure that everyone gets a copy of this book, Romanism and the Reformation, by Henry Grattan Guinness.